Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for staying with us. This is today's last session and a very important one. Carla Leon will be talking about blended learning. Let me tell you something about teacher Carla Leon. She has a bachelor's degree in linguistics and languages, English specialty. She has been working as an English teacher at the CBA for the past 5 years. She has worked with different levels from A1 to C2, including the postgraduate courses at the CBA. She has also plenty of experience working with students of different ages. Currently, she's working on a project based on the elaboration of a syllabus using the blended learning approach. Furthermore, she has done deep research on the topic aforementioned. Without further ado, with you, teacher Carla Leon.
Teacher Carla, thank you very much.
How are you today?
Hello, hello, everybody. Thank you very much, José Manuel. Well, I'm very happy to be here with you in this opportunity. As José Manuel said, we are going to talk about an innovative teaching approach, which is blended learning. Please, I would like you to join to the link that has been shared with you through the chat box on YouTube and Facebook so that we can get started.
Yeah, please join the link that I just shared with you. You can see it on your screen too. You just had to hit that link. Well, there are some people who are greeting us.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm going to try to share my screen now.
All right.
I don't know what's the problem.
It's okay. Well, it seems that there has been some technical problem, but don't worry, everything is going to be okay. Good vibes. You got this. Hey, teacher Carlita.
Sorry, I'm not with you now.
That's all right.
Yes, you can share. I'm trying to share, but it stops working. Now,
is it possible? I think it's working now.
Great.
I think it's working now.
All right. All right. Then. We can get started. I have people connecting. So you can continue connecting on the application in order to interact directly here. Or if you want, also you can share your responses through the chat box. Okay. The first thing that you are going to see on the application are these faces. Okay. I would like you please to circle the face that represents how you're feeling right now. I know that's been a long day, you know, with the presentations, but I would like to see how you're doing with a peer deck application. Or you can also write your responses on the chat box. Okay, so we have responses already. Thank you very much. I can see that you're not having problems. Great. So let's start with the topic. Again, we are going to talk about this innovative teaching approach, which is blended learning. I imagine that some of you have already heard, learned, or maybe you maybe have also applied this approach to your classrooms, right? So the idea of this workshop is to build up more information regarding blended learning. You can see here in the title that it says also creating an integrated classroom. What does integrated mean for blended learning? Well, we actually can bring or gather, you know, teachers, students, and contents into a good experience. This means that not a single student, no matter the age of the student, the situation, or maybe some problems that the student may have, is going to be left aside on the learning process. And the same for teachers. The idea is for teachers to feel confident at a moment of sharing or working with different activities with their students so that they will achieve all the goals that they set at the beginning of the course. Okay? You know that any educational institution has the main goal to enrich a student's knowledge at a quality level, of course, right? Any teacher in the world wants to see their students succeed with no exceptions. Hence, we may bear in mind something that is very important, that is the evolution. This is very important. Because when we talk about evolution, we not only talk about the evolution of the world itself, but the evolution of the educational approaches. That is something very important that we are going to talk about today, that is the blended learning, that is the part of the evolution of the educational approaches. Then talking about the technologies and the language, you know, that as English teachers, we should constantly bear in mind that a language is always changing. When we talk about technology, we can say that technology brings skills, knowledge, process, and tools together for solving problems of human beings. And why am I talking about technology? Because, yeah, imagine what, that technology is actually one characteristic of blended learning. Furthermore, you know that after the quarantine and all the process that we have been through, we've learned, most of us have learned from zero to use the technology. And I imagine that the majority of you right now cannot imagine a world without technology. Yes? So once again, this presentation is being created with the idea of innovating the teaching and learning experiences for students and for teachers. Yes? Unlike traditional instruction, a blended approach gives the opportunity to take the best of on-site and online classes. All right? So let's move on. Okay, so in this part, we are going to first focus on the students' needs and development. And in order to do so, first, we are going to talk about some characteristics that I imagine that we all teachers have identified at least in one of our students. You know that some students, for example, don't have studying habits, yes? They lack of practice, they just do the assignments in order to get points and not to learn. Yes, some other students are not motivated. They don't feel motivated, and when they are not motivated, they might start thinking that the subject is too hard for them, and that may lead for them to quit the course, right? Some other students may have some concentration problems or even ADHD, you know? And others may forget what they have learned during remote class because they cannot retain this information the same way as others do. Some students can work at slower pace than the rest. You know, those kind of students who are like struggling with an assignment while others finish very fast, right? So you may wonder, why am I talking about the problems right now? Because it's very important to identify the problems before we talk about the solutions, right? So let's see. Now is the time for you to participate again, okay? Why do you think students present any of the difficulties mentioned before? Again, you can add your responses using the application on Pure Deck, or you can directly write your responses on the chat box. All right, and José Manuel is going to help me reading some of the responses as well. Thank you very much. We are going to click this. Okay. Why do you think students present any of the difficulties mentioned before?
We do not have answers in the chat box, not yet. They ask me if there's an access.
All right, we have some answers here, like for example, lack of information. It's not an access code. They can directly access using the link, or if you cannot access the link, don't worry, you can just participate using the chat box, okay? Don't worry. All right. Okay, so it says because the ground knowledge. Okay, good. Because there is no varied activities, all the students are different. Yes, definitely, all students are different because of the environment. All right, very good. Thank you very much for participating.
Anel says let's because they are bored.
Well, now that we analyze this aspect regarding the problems that we may identify in students, we are going to see the other side of the coin, okay? Let's participate once again, please. In your opinion, what characteristics does the ideal student have? By ideal, I mean a student who you think that is a good student, students that you would like to have all the time in your classes. Let's see. Your responses. We are going to have like 10 seconds again to answer. Eager to learn, okay. Creative, self-motivated. They must have intrinsic motivation. Great. Willing to learn, responsible, motivated. An outgoing student, very good.
We also have responsible students, happy to keep learning.
All right, yes. You have actually mentioned very important characteristics that students should have, which is great, thank you. There is actually one characteristic that I think that involves everything that you have just said right now, which is to be independent, an independent learner. Why? Because an independent learner actually is always motivated. You know, an independent learner works at his or her own pace, looks for additional information or does research by his or her own. And of course, an independent learner, since it's very motivated, doing the tasks, et cetera, is always collaborative with his or her peers. So, what we want to get as teachers and using the blended learning model is to get independent learners. All right, so there are three aspects that we are going to consider when we get to talk about blended learning. So you are creating an idea of what blended learning means, right? First of all, we said to create an independent learner on each student that we have in the classroom. Yes, with no exceptions. We can use technology and we can produce, of course, an active learning process inside and outside the classroom. Okay? Let's take into account, please, this part taken from the Essentials for Blended Learning book. This is from Jared Stein and Charles R. Graham that states that to create a new learning environment for their students, research suggests that blended courses can have a positive impact on efficiency, confidence, and learning outcomes. Yes? So that is like a brief introduction of blended learning. Now we have to get into the important part. We are going to talk about blended learning in three steps. What is blended learning? Why should we blend our classes? And how can we blend our classes? All right, let's get started with the first part. What is blended learning? Well, blended learning may seem to have a very simple definition, such as many authors mention, that is the combination between online tools and on-site classes. Nevertheless, this definition is too general for us to actually comprehend all the benefits that this approach has. And it's also too general that it may lead to misunderstand the concept of blended learning with other concepts. So first, we are first going to talk about what blended learning is not, okay? So what is not blended learning? Blended learning is not technology integration. But why? If I said that we are going to use technology, right? Well, technology integration is, for example, when you bring a cool technology tool or activity into the classroom to enhance the learning process. For example, if you have your students watch a video in the classroom and you hand out some worksheets so they can complete. Or maybe if you use like an application like Kahoot, for example, from time to time for your students to practice. That is not blended learning, okay? That is called technology integration. Another concept that can be confused with blended learning is the hybrid learning. Hybrid learning is the combination of traditional face-to-face classes and online teaching practices, yes? The difference is that the student gets to choose either to attend classes face-to-face, partly or fully, or online classes, partly or fully as well, or mix them both, all right? So that is the difference, basically. And finally, we have the online learning. Blended learning is not online learning. I imagine that you all are involved already with this term, which is online. You know that this is fully online. It's not face-to-face. We need a high-speed internet connection and some devices like a computer, laptop, smartphones, et cetera, right? So those are the concepts that maybe many people confuse blended learning with. Now we are going to talk about what is blended learning, okay? Blended learning is integrating ICTS, that is information and communication technologies, into the course design. That is the difference. It's not the same of integrating technology in the classroom than to integrating into the course design, okay? This in order to improve the teaching and learning experiences for students and teachers by enabling them to engage in ways that will not normally be available in for them in their usual environment, okay? What is also blended learning? Well, blended learning is fully online and fully physical, unlike hybrid learning or online, for example, okay? In the blended model, a face-to-face interaction is key part of education that cannot be provided just online, okay? Actually, the online delivery assignments are always thought in order to complement and supplement the face-to-face classes. All right. What is also blended learning? Well, it is a student-centered pedagogical approach. If we say that it's student-centered, it's because it's possible to personalize the learning into the student, to focus directly on the student. Okay, and this is where technology is very important, because with the technology integration, we can actually afford the student a more personalized learning experience by, for example, giving them more material tools that they can use at any moment and they can work at their own pace, et cetera, which take us again to have independent learners. Okay. All right. So after we have reviewed these concepts, it's time for you to participate again. You can see here that we have some characteristics, yes, of blended learning. I would like you please to circle only the characteristics that belong to blended learning, which are not all of them, of course, right? Only the ones that belong to blended learning. Let's see your responses. We have responses. Not yet. 10 seconds, please, to respond. Okay, good. Blended learning. Let's see your responses. Okay, you mark them. It's okay. If you mark them only, it's also okay. Don't worry. All right, let's see the responses. Okay, blended learning is, well, yes, you can personalize the learning experience. Very good. Material available at all times. Good. Students work at their own pace. Great. There is one more. Let's see if another person got it. Okay, well, not fully online. Blended learning is face-to-face and online. It's not fully online. So this is online classes, all right? So it's not part of the blended learning. The one that was missing is that it is used to complement the class, because we said that when we deliver assignments online, they work in order to complement the face-to-face classes. Okay. All right. Thank you very much for your participation. We have a clear idea of what is blended learning. Now, please, let's answer to this statement. What do you think? When you are teaching a diverse group, it's almost impossible to tailor the learning experience to suit every learner. Do you think this is true or false? When you are teaching a diverse group, it's almost impossible to tailor the learning experience to suit every learner. True or false? What do you think? Do we have any answers on the chat box? Because I only have 9 here, 10, 12.
Well, Walter says it's false. Marcela says it's false. Just two answers in the meantime.
Okay. Well, actually, if we say when we are teaching a diverse group, yes, different kinds of students, they come from different parts. Maybe they have some problems, the ones that we were identifying before. It's almost impossible to tailor the learning experience to suit every learner. Well, actually, not. It's not impossible. This is false. Okay. A blended learning model can help you personalize your subject matter for every student. Okay. But implementing a blended learning model requires big changes to how you think about teaching. So the first thing that we have to do is to change our thinking as teachers in order to suit a plan that fulfills better for our group needs and for every student who is in our group. In order to do so, we are going to get to start talking about different blended learning models. Okay, we have plenty of blended learning models, but today I'm just going to talk about 4 of them, okay? The ones that I consider the most interesting ones and the ones that are the most used in different parts of the world, especially in the United States. All right. So in order to personalize, again, I'm repeating, in order to personalize your plan, your planning into your group, you have to be able to understand your group's needs. Okay. And once you do that, you can work with one of the models that I'm going to present right now. The first model is the lab rotation model. Okay, what is the lab rotation model? Well, students rotate on a fixed schedule, okay, among locations in which at least one is a lab. All right, you can see here in the picture, we have the direct instruction, and we have the online lab reading. So the students can rotate from the classroom to the lab, okay? Students rotate from the classroom to the lab. different activities are placed in each setting. And we are going to see an example so you can understand better how this works. Again, you have here different stages. We have direct instruction, and finally the lab, the learning lab. What can we do in direct instruction? The teacher can work with the small groups, lectures, debates, role playing in direct instruction, the same way as we all do during classes, right? After at a fixed schedule, the students go to the lab, okay, and they can work with other activities, like for example, self-paced lessons, research, digital creation, educational games, everything that is going to support everything that they did in the direct instruction in the classroom. Yes, so that is the way that they rotate. Of course, the institution that you are going to apply this should have a lab only for the students to go sit and start working on the computers. Yes, that is something that you have to also take into account. The second model that I'm going to talk about is the station rotation model. Okay, the same. Students rotate on a fixed schedule or the teacher's discretion among the classroom-based modalities. What is the difference? They don't have to go to a different lab. They have different stations inside the classroom with different activities, and they rotate from one station to the other. What are some of the advantages that this model has is that students rotate in groups, in small groups, from one learning station to another one. This allows teachers to work with smaller groups, so the teacher can identify who is the student who's having more problems with the assignments, yes? The fact that they are working in smaller groups doesn't mean that they are doing collaborative work. They can still work individually, but in the different stations, okay? And it's also going to facilitate the use of project-based learning, which is something really good for the students at the moment of working with deeper activities, yes? In the case of project-based learning, we can work with collaborative work. They can interact, they can share their ideas and be creative. An example that we have for the station rotation model, you can see here in this chart, some ideas of how you can create your stations inside the classroom. Okay, it also depends, of course, on the number of students that you have. It's not just necessary that you can create three stations. You can create four stations or five inside a classroom with different activities, okay? But remember that at least one of the stations should be online, to work online, right? So station number one can be computer-based instruction. Students can work independently. Station number two, teacher-led. They can work in small groups instruction. Station three, they can work in a collaborative form with deeper activities, yes, with project based, for example. So that is the way that they rotate inside the classroom. Okay. The third model that we have today is the flipped classroom, model. This is called flipped because it actually breaks the rules of the tradition. Completely breaks the rules of the traditional model, okay? As you can see here in the picture, in the traditional model, the instruction or the lecture is given in the classroom, yes? And then the practice, that is homework, is done at home, and the student works alone. In the case of the flipped classroom, the instruction or the lecture is done at home. So I imagine that a teacher, for example, can create something nice like a video or a presentation for the students so that they can work at home, take notes or work with some worksheets, assignments or questionnaires, etc. And then what they were supposed to do as homework, they will do it in the classroom. Yes. What are the advantages of the flipped classroom model is that this frees up time in class to help with problem sets. Students watch the lectures at home. Students get help with assignments by the teacher directly, and students can review the lectures at home as many times as they want. And again, this helps the student to be more independent because they have the material, and actually when they get to work on the practices in the classroom, the teacher can directly work with them and see what are their doubts or what problems do they have. All right, so this is an example of a flipped classroom model. The teacher assigns students to watch and take notes of grammar, of a grammar video at home. And after that, in the classroom, the teacher facilitates face-to-face guided practice and collaborative projects. Yes? So this is an example of the flipped classroom. The last model that we have is the individual rotation model. What is different from individual rotation than the rest of the rotation models? Well, actually, this is more applied for students who have different necessities. Okay, you know that not all the students work the same or they don't function the same. Some students might be more visual, for example, some others would like to learn better by memorizing, or some may work better with online tools, some others with a pencil and paper assignments, you know. This is, for example, the stations that we have in individual rotation is different because students don't need to go to all the stations. They don't need to go to all the stations. Either the teacher can assign them some stations that they can work with, or they can choose as well. Well, I work whether with this or this other one, yes? And this works better for those students who don't have studying habits, because the teacher can fix their schedules and say, okay, first you're going to work on this, after on this, then at home you work with this. Yes, and the teacher can be assigning, so the student is going to work in a more organized way. Well, the advantages, it allows a student to work at his or her own pace. Students can work, who can use the modality that best works for them. And students who need a learning routine can be scheduled to some activities. An example for this rotation, for the individual rotation, as you can see here, the rotation can be not only inside the institution, but also at home, yes, with different practices or assignments or activities that they can develop. Well, some students spend more time completing online instruction because they don't like working on a pencil and paper assignments. Yes, these students rotate to other groups such as intervention, teacher-led instruction, and group projects, everything that has to do online. In that case, it is possible. Of course, they will share everything inside the classroom with a face-to-face class, but the stations that they choose, in this case, is online, are online because they believe that they work better in that way. Which model would you apply? I would like you to choose, please. You are going to see the different options. You just have to choose the one that called your attention the most, or maybe the one that you liked the most. If you are not working on the link, please feel free to share your answers on the chat box of YouTube or Facebook. All right, so we have different responses already. Thank you very much. Okay. Well, of course, it has to do a lot with your necessities as teachers and the group that you are pretending to teach as well, right? The schedule, everything has to do in order to choose a model. Thank you very much for sharing the one that you believe will best suit on your plan. Why do you think we should blend our classes? Why do you think we should blend our classes? Can you write your answers, please? either on the chat box or here on the application. I would like to see what you think. Do we have any responses on the chat box or not?
Not yet. They are still answering the previous question. Some people say flipped classroom, station rotation, etc.
Right. In order to complete sounds, okay. Yes, very nice response to make our students independent. Great. To have an interactive class to improve students' learning. All right, very nice response here. To have interactive and collaborative learning, to have more options to reach the attention and understanding from our students. To reach all our students, to make the learning process more dynamic, great. To give students opportunity to socialize and learn from others. I agree with all of you. Great responses. Thank you very much. Actually, there are many reasons why to blend. Yes, actually, the ones that you provided are very accurate with the ones that I am going to explain right now. It's pretty simple, but of course, I mean, you have the idea, but of course, it's very important to try to develop a little bit more. We should blend our classes to have, you know, broaden spaces and opportunities for learning. Students can reach the different assignments, tools, or material that you provide for them any place, in any place at home, while they are going to their job, for example. They can watch the videos while they are, in the bus, something like that. You know that we have a lot of students who work, study, have many activities during the day, right? So that is why the blended learning takes into account every kind of learner. Okay. Support course management activities, of course, the activities that we have face to face, you know, that we have like short time for face to face classes, we are going to support them using online tools for with assignments that they can do at home, etc. Provision of information and resources to students. What you are going to provide to students. Yes, are you going to provide to them with some worksheets or maybe videos? We all know plenty of material that we can use from the internet, right? Engage and motivate students through interactivity and collaboration. It is possible for them to interact not only inside a classroom, but also outside using the different technologies. It takes every kind of learner into account. That's what I was saying before, you know, to take into account every learner needs. It utilizes a variety of methodologies. It's very helpful, this part, in order to start elaborating our course planning. The content is customized to the learner and optimized to the subject matter. It means that the content that we have in our books is going to fit for every learner. Yes, and it's going to be optimized for our subject, for our purposes, right, as teachers. And finally, learners lead and choose considering their needs and style. And this is, of course, depending a lot on the model that you use, but somehow learners are going to get to choose the pace or the form, the assignments that they want to work. All right, okay. Finally, well, we talked about all the concepts, right? Now we have to talk about the process, the action, yes? How to blend? How do we start blending our courses? Well, It is very important for us to bear in mind that there is a process to follow whenever we want to start designing our course program, okay, for blended learning. The group preparation is essential in the construction and maintenance of our resources and the creation of quality learning experiences for our students. So let's follow these steps, please. We have planning, designing and developing, implementing, and finally, evaluate. Those are the steps that we have to follow. When we get to the planning part, yes, we need to understand what is your situation. Think, what is the situation? And when we talk about the situation, it is the most important part of the whole process of elaborating our course design in blended learning. Why? Because in this part, we are going to develop the learning objectives of the entire course. And when we talk about the learning objectives, we talk about what do you want your students to be able to do at the end of the course? Yes. What do you want? Why do you think your students should take this course? Okay, those are the learning objectives. All right. Then we have to consider the course context. And when we talk about context, we talk about environment, right? Do you have multiple classrooms or labs or theaters in the institution that you are going to work with? Yes. You must consider also the teaching team. Are you going to work alone? Are you going to work in pairs? Who's going to provide you the material that you are going to share with your students? And of course, you have to consider the institution culture and policies, the syllables that the institution works with. Do you think it's going to be suitable to work with blended learning in this institution? And finally, please, let's consider who are our students. Yes, who are your students? Well, how old are they? What's the year and the level of the study that they have? What's the class number that you have? Is it a large class? Is it a small class? What's the accessibility that your students have to internet connection and technology? What is the experience and motivation that the students have on the usage of technology? Yes. The skills that they have using applications, etc., etc. So in the planning section, it's like you are studying, you are given like a first glance to everything that you have to take into account before you go to the second step. Yes. And again, I repeat, the most important step that you have to take here is to state your aims and learning objectives. Once you have that, you can start working with the second part, which is the designing and developing. Okay. In order to work with this part, not make it like very long because of the time factor that we have, we are going to just work with 3 points. Okay. We are going to follow the constructive alignment model of curriculum design. We said that the most important step to take was the learning objectives. According to the learning objectives, we are going to identify our students' needs, okay? The institution needs, the students' needs, and using everything or using those things, we are going to work with the teaching and learning activities and resources that you are going to give the students, okay? Finally, these two are going to lead to the assessed outcomes. What are the outcomes that you are going to have at the end of these activities or resources that you are providing the students according to the learning objectives? All right. Before we move on, please, I would like to see how you're doing with the presentation. Let's try to drag the blue dot that you are going to find on your screen. With your finger, please drag it to the person that represents you, okay? I remind you that you can also write your responses in the chat box of YouTube. All right, great. The majority of you are in the green spot, so that's great. I'm very happy that you actually understood the topic. Well, we have some people who are a little confused. Okay, don't worry. We are going to continue explaining. If you have any questions at the end, you can write them on the chat box, please. Okay. The next step for the course design is the implementation. We have to take into account that if we don't analyze different aspects, we are going to fail on the elaboration of our course design. The aspects that we have to analyze are the course orientation, preparing students, and supporting and sustaining student learning. When we work with the course orientation, for example, we must see what is the purpose that we have with our students. And this purpose is what you have to make clear to your students, okay? The expectations that you have at the end of the course, the same. From the beginning, you have to set your expectations. You have to tell your expectations to your students, okay? Then talking about the guidelines. Since this is a blended learning course, you are going to choose different tools, like, for example, I don't know, Google Classroom, ClassDojo, Kahoot, maybe some applications that you are going to be using with the students. If the student doesn't have the knowledge to use any of these applications, so you have to provide guidelines to the students so that they can read the guidelines, they can study the guidelines, and they are not going to have problems using these applications, okay? Finally, the community. You have to build a sense of community among students in your group from the beginning as well. Students must feel part of a group with a shared purpose and meaningful identity. Otherwise, they will feel like they are not part of what you are planning to do with the course, and they are not going to feel motivated. Now, we are going to continue talking about motivation. You have to prepare your students before you start a blended course, okay? First, you take the student point of view. Tell your students what is the blended course about, and ask them what is their opinion about it. If students are not going to be heard by the teacher, they are maybe not going to feel motivated, right? Then, of course, you have to give plenty of leading time for students to use technology, especially if the applications or technologies that you are going to use are for the first time for them. You have to give them more time and be patient for them to use them with no problems, okay? Finally, what we have to analyze, supporting and sustaining student learning. After you talk with your students and try to motivate them to participate, actively participate on the ideas that they have about blended learning, you have to promote and encourage the students' use of blended learning. Yes, put them into the practice of using the blended learning components, yes? And monitor the students' participation. Identify those students who you think they are not participating, they are not like confident on using the tools or implementing the planning on their learning process, so that you can have a word with them, you can talk with them, you can try to solve the problem from the beginning, okay? Finally, we have the evaluation. I remind you that the evaluation is not for the students, okay? The students are the ones who are going to be evaluating the course design that you prepare for them. It's not necessary to wait until the end of the course for them to evaluate your course. You can collect feedback for continuous improvement throughout the course, Yes, and we can evaluate in three different forms. We can evaluate the pedagogies, the learning activities which underpin the unit, the resources that you provide, yes, the content and information which are provided for the learners, and the delivery strategies that you used during the course, issues associated with the ways in which the course is delivered to the learners. So maybe at the end of an activity, an assignment, or a class, you can ask the students to evaluate the process using rubrics or maybe questionnaires, yes, so that they will feel free and they will feel part of your planning, yes? That is the purpose of the evaluation. All right, so in conclusion, you know that as teachers and educators, we never stop learning. And again, this is like an innovative approach. And since we all are already familiarized with the use of technology, and we are coming back to our face-to-face classes, I imagine that's going to be way much easier for you to evolve and to change and use this kind of approach. Again, as educators, we should have the thought of upgrading our skills, growing and changing together with the world. Thank you very much. Please leave a comment or a question. I guess that we have some minutes to answer.
Yes, we do. Thank you very much, dear Carlita. That was such a great presentation. Let's see what teachers say. Did you have any questions first, teachers? You can write your question in the chat box.
We can some comments. Much.
Well, there are no questions, but just good comments on your presentation. Great job. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Carlito. Very useful ideas. Nice presentation. Thank you. Thank you. Virtual hug there. Thanks a lot for such great presentation. Congratulations. Thank you. Carlita, there's a question here, maybe an example. It was interesting, but an example, it's not very specific as we have seen many different types of blended learning. Thanks, great presentation. Thank you. Cool work. Congratulations, great presentation. Thank you so much. Thank you. Interesting. Great job. Thanks a lot. Well, once again, Carlita, I thank you very much on behalf of the CBA. It was such a great presentation, and it's something that we should apply from now on. Now that we are going to in-person classes, blended learning is such a good option. Dear teachers, remember tomorrow is the last day of this virtual conference. We begin very early at 8 o'clock. Thank you, Carlita.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Have a good one.
Bye-bye. Thank you.